You know what we didn't do last show, Andrew?
What did we do?
We did our chatter.
Yeah.
And I had to find a suction more in the middle and do, but we never did the Andrew Bauman.
Hey, Rob.
We never did that.
Oh.
Now we're going to have to do it twice.
Okay. Hey, Rob.
No.
Let's do it again.
When it's least expected.
Oh. Wow.
This is Auggie, huh?
Yeah.
How long have you had Auggie?
We got him in late September.
And you have two other dogs?
Two other dogs, yes.
The new baby.
Yes.
And what was the rationale for that?
There was no rationale.
No rationale. You just
no.
You frequent. Do you like my wife Brenda does and just every once in a while check all the adoption places or
well,
like
I,
online or I mean.
I check them every day.
But that is definitely going to increase the odds of you having an
adoption. Picking up a new dog.
Yeah.
Arizona is a wildly beautiful place, brimming with over 100 brewing companies. I'm Rob Fulmer, the executive director of the Arizona Craft Brewers Guild. I'm joined by Deputy Director Andrew Bauman. Together, we cover the state, bringing you the best of what's happening at our breweries and beyond. Welcome to Arizona Beer Frontier.
But we got Auggie because I volunteer for the Compassion with Fashion event for the Arizona Humane Society. So I'm on the committee that helps put together that event. And he came to one of our meetings and I'm like, right before he was supposed to go on the adoption floor. And I'm like, I think I can get another dog. So I went home, asked Phil. Phil's like, yes.
Wow.
And then now we have three dogs, which is a lot of dogs. I mean,
that is a lot.
Yeah. 200 pounds of dogs is a lot of dogs.
Woo.
Wow.
Yeah. It's a lot.
It's like they should have a government write-off for that.
Yes.
Like, I know everyone jokes like, oh, this dog's my dependent. But like, when you start reaching, you know, full-scale human weight class, I think it's, it's somewhat justified. But that's great. I didn't really connect that. Of course, I knew that you were working with the Humane Society and doing events and things. And that's sometimes when I ask an event question, you sort of reflect upon how things are for those smaller type, well, not smaller organization, but you don't do beer, you do a beer adjacent things occasionally, but not to the scale. So, I mean, you have that experience. And as long as we're going there, you are a liquor retailer.
Oh, hey.
I am.
Would you like to introduce yourself?
Yes.
Great.
I'm Camila.
Camila Alarcon is an attorney at Alarcon Law and Policy, PLLC in Phoenix, Arizona. Her practice includes administrative agency practice and administrative law policy. She has been recognized by Best Lawyers since 2023. Camila currently serves as general counsel for the Arizona Craft Brewers Guild.
Camila. Can you spell that? No.
you might have to because I remember when we started working together and I was like, there's men of certain age that just will just call you Camille and they cannot not do that.
Yeah.
Does that happen?
All the time.
Oh.
And I'm like, I've been messing people's name up. I messed up Adrian Fontes. I call him Fonts.
Twice.
And I knew, and it was because, you know what? It was because when we talked about Zanjero, I was like, because I knew it's not the hard J, but he's like, Adam, Wojciech. Right. So there's another complicated name.
Yes.
Said that even Hispanic people call it
Zanjero.
Zanjero.
Yeah.
So I was thinking about that and I'm like, fonts. It's terrible.
Got in your own head.
I mean, because I know Alejandro for many, many years. I don't call him Handro Fonts. I don't know. But you don't listen Camila listens to this show. So I Hladilinka. I had to. That was the beer pour with the.
Oh yeah. Yeah.
So I found the Czech pronunciation of that. Did I do
jammed font? It in did there?
I did one other one. I might have even done Fontes. I did one other name in there. Anyway.
So we were talking about our good friend.
Alarcon.
No, I thought it was the kind of pour, right? Yeah. Weren't you guys talking about?
Yeah, that was one of them. But I also did one more for somebody's name or something.
Okay.
But is it Alarcon? Alarcon?
It's Alarcon.
Yeah, but
yes,
you
Alarcon's fine.
You Americanize it.
I do a lot. Yes.
Or you just accept it?
I don't know. Alarcon is really hard.
Yeah.
Like that's asking a lot of people.
Yeah, I mean, sure.
I mean, I mess up names all the time.
Well, I mean, so just to give you,
I can't get mad.
Just to give you, a non or more standardized American English name that gets messed up that I even asked him about is people call him Chuck Knoll, but it's mm-hmm. Chuck Nall.
Oh, Nall. Okay.
And but he'll answer it either, and he'll. But if so, you ask so him, like, how is it really pronounced? He's like, well, in Pennsylvania, it's Knoll.
Okay.
Not Knoll, but he doesn't care, right? And then we're talking about Taylor Swift's boyfriend.
Yeah,
is it Kels or Kelsey?
Kelsey.
But it's really Kels. But they just kind of roll with it. That came out during the.
Chuck told
you
that.
I guess you're not. No. I guess you're not as big a Taylor fan as I thought, Andrew.
Probably not. Everyone loves to think I go super into things. Like, my family had a bacon birthday for me. Mm-hmm. And I was like, I like bacon, but I'm not obsessed with it.
Right. Yeah. For a hot minute, like, I said I wanted an angel food cake for my birthday cake one year. And then, like, I had it. I'm like, eh. And then I got it for the next 10 years until I just said, you right. know.
Yes.
You can go back to the chocolate cake with chocolate frosting and chocolate, chocolate, chocolate. Anyway.
So we were saying our friend Camila
Alarcon
is now a retailer.
Yes. Right, yes.
Yes.
You want to share that new story with us?
Yeah. With my brother and my sister-in-law and my husband, we own Spin the Bottle, which is in downtown Chandler. So we've been open since mid-November, and we carry only Arizona beers, but we carry wines from all over the place, mm-hmm. and including Arizona, of course.
Right on. And I didn't tell you how to do exclusively Arizona, or nor did Andrew.
No. This was our choice.
Okay.
I mean, we have over 100 breweries.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. Feel like we can represent any style of beer that you want.
They seem to be popular here. I don't know what to tell you, but yeah, you do have to make a conscious choice because right now Petal House isn't packaging, but they will.
I hope so. Really
Very soon. Yeah.
I hope so.
And Santan's in the neighborhood, and
the Perch.
Perch.
Mm-hmm. And the former brewery known as Look Cinemas.
Yeah. Yeah. They closed, by the way.
Oh, they did?
Well, they closed for brewing operations.
They had to make some capital investments, and there was a.
But the movie theater's still open.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. Well, we're having a sad moment.
Yes,
we do really like what Marisa was brewing over there, and I think that was a place. It's unfortunate because like people ask me what's hidden gem, and I got to tell them it's a brewery that's in Chandler that they don't probably know about, even though they're right in the neighborhood.
So. Yeah,
but she'll land in the right spot somewhere. She's a good brewer. She used to work at White Claw, and then she's got a wine background.
Oh, nice.
Lived and worked in New Mexico. Loves horses in America too. She does love horses. So you have some new perspective on the other side of the. I used to say other side of the bar, but I guess you're a bar member.
Yeah.
Now you are.
Yeah, it's I mean, it's definitely eye opening. Mm-hmm. I mean, I never thought it was easy. I always thought what I did was easy compared to what my clients do. There's absolutely no doubt about that.
You spend less time trying to get things done that are not quite legal or trying to scheme around the law that a lot of your clients are probably like, hey, how do I get this done even though I even I know it's not technically legal? Is that,
No. My clients are all compliant.
Yeah, no, I'm sure they're all compliant. But they're
they all compliant. I'm sure
all the time.
All the time.
What about if we did this? What about if my brother-in-law did this? No. Okay.
You're fine. No, they're good. But it is really hard. It's you're trying to figure out what people want, which is very difficult. You have to be compliant with a whole bunch of laws that don't necessarily make sense.
Right.
Or apply.
Yeah, sure. And to nobody's fault, right? I mean, we just write year after year, law on top of law. Like, it's just Title IV is probably 50% larger than it was when I started this in 2007. So, you know, you're like, oh, wait, that doesn't match this and so forth. But, you know, we're just a Series 10. So that's pretty easy.
Yeah, yeah.
You know,
Series 10 is a convenience store license, typically?
A beer and wine store license.
Okay.
Right. Formerly known as a convenience store license. Okay. Until all the convenience stores got Series 9s.
Which is?
A full beer, wine, and spirits. So we do not sell spirits.
Right.
Much to the chagrin of people that walk in asking for tequila. But I love not selling spirits.
Yeah.
So,
yeah. I mean, they have those malt-based ones now, but that's not really the customer that's asking for tequila.
We get
the minute you start selling fake Fireball, I'll know you've jumped the shark.
Yeah, we try to avoid a few things.
You might as well put gas pumps in then.
Yeah. Then you are. But it's lots of fun,
It's in downtown Chandler.
Chandler.
Near Pedal House.
Yes, it is.
Saba's.
It is on Boston Street, 105 West Boston. And we are right next door to the religious store.
Yep. Across the street from Paletas Betty.
Yes.
Yep.
I love Paletas Betty.
And Backyard Barbecue.
Yes. Right next door to
Do you know they sell firearms at Saba's?
No.
So do they sell?
Well, I don't know. Still, like as of a year and a half ago.
Oh,
yeah.
Okay.
Huh.
I mean, it's a small display case. It looks like, I'll get some guns. I'm going to sell them. I don't know.
Just I'll keep that in mind next time I'm on my way to Chop Shop.
I don't know. It is probably.
When my brother's too busy to make me food.
You probably ask him. They're probably like, yeah, we were here. We were the only building, and this is what we did. So we never stopped.
Yeah.
They've been there a while.
Oh, yeah. So. They've been there for a long time.
Yeah.
So one of the reasons we chose downtown Chandler is because my brother and my sister-in-law have a restaurant right around the corner called Mingle and Grace, which is very popular there, as it should be, because the food's excellent. Mm-hmm. You've eaten there?
Yes. Yeah.
Have you eaten there? Oh, yeah.
Okay.
So I'm just starting to realize I listed a bunch of businesses, and I'm like, I used to live within walking distance of that area, and there was nothing there. And then a couple things happened, and then some things turned over. But, I mean, you've got a lot of stuff there that makes that a walkable area. Should people choose to do that, you know.
They do. It's pretty jump in there on Thursdays, Fridays, Saturdays, Sundays.
Yeah. I remember the biggest thing that happened to downtown Chandler was the Ostrich Festival and Cheap Trick played.
Ooh.
And we walked, and we could hear Robin Zander singing all the way from my house. Kind of followed the music. I'm like, Cheap Trick is playing? It's crazy.
We lived on Alma School and Germain from 2004.
Sorry, no, 2005
till 2014.
Mm-hmm.
And so when Santan got there in 2007, it was like the best thing that had happened.
Yeah, I think I left in 2006. Yeah. And I'm like, but that was sort of it wasn't pre-internet per se, but it was pre-knowing about things on the internet. Like,
yeah. I first got on Facebook in 2008. So it was,
And even nobody knew, like, you'd have to wait for, like, you know, the Republic Go section to pick up a story about that thing. And they weren't really writing stories about new breweries or anything like that at the time, you know?
I don't even know how we came across it, but we did it. And mm-hmm. we were like, this is awesome. Like, we have a brewery that's like a mile from our house. This is the best thing.
Yeah.
Well, and a good one, too.
We should have played the harp music. We're reminiscing. So we sort of pre-discussed a couple of topics to talk about that are topical. And that can definitely affect our members. Definitely, you know, if you're just a regular person that goes to events and enjoys going to breweries or restaurants or bars when they have something going on, event-wise, you might not hear about this because potentially you're only seeing a fraction of what some of these bars and restaurants and breweries and want to do, and it has to do with extending their premise. It's for either just regular service or to do something in conjunction with a special event, or it could be a few more feet for a patio.
Yep.
Or it could be the entire parking lot. So their extension of premise. And we recently had some discussions about how this works at the state level, but then we kind of, as an organization, we're really tuned around state law, because of the 100 breweries, they're all in 30, 40, 50 municipalities. I mean, if you want to get down to what affects a business, I mean, it could be more than just a city. It could be county issues. It could be, I don't know, downtown overlays, right? Or special districts could come into play. So it would be exceedingly hard for us to be up to speed on all that stuff. And that's usually one of the first things that people ask us when they start a brewery, like, can you help me navigate getting a license? And like, well, you know, just in a city, you've got what? Zoning.
Mm-hmm. You've got water, you've got fire, you've got
all the,
everybody.
All the building codes.
Get your TPT.
I'll work on different timelines. And so we don't specialize in that, but we help one out when we can. You probably get that question a lot too, right?
Oh yeah. And I mean, I won't do use permits for, you know, zoning, but, you know, part of the liquor license application is to get approval from all of the city departments that you are operating well and that you are within all of the codes. So most cities won't sign off on an approval for your liquor license without you already being compliant with everything. Now, we do have a statute that says that they can't deny you or recommend disapproval, technically. Recommend, because they don't issue state licenses, only the state does, that they can't have a recommendation for disapproval based on zoning. But they find ways around it. There are, you know, sort of egregious offenders of that will remain nameless, but,
offenders in terms of municipalities, licensee applicants.
Yeah. That whether you have, this is my theory, is that whether you have the correct use permit, is irrelevant to whether or not the state can issue you a liquor license. Because if you don't have the correct use permit, the city's not going to give you a certificate of occupancy. Right. So you should be able to have your liquor license, and you have that, check it off your to-do list, and then you're like, okay, now I need my use permit. I know I can't open because I don't have my certificate of occupancy, and I can't do anything without that certificate of occupancy.
Right.
that's the power that they have.
Right. So if they, if the city had a reason to deny you, they, that's their statutorily approved way of doing it.
Yeah. If they don't want you open for business, they have plenty of tools in their tool shed to do that. To ask a business owner, oh, you have to completely navigate all of this and all of this has to be approved at the same time.
Right.
Instead of just doing it step by step, is it's really hard for a lot of people to maneuver around. And then you don't want to start your liquor license too late because it is going to take a few months.
Right.
So if you do it after you've done all of your use permitting,
right,
then you're asking them not to be open for another 3 to 4 months.
Right. So I didn't understand this as it was written on paper when we were talking about hypotheticals. But one example that you, whether it's based on real life or not, we'll never know.
Never know.
Is that you could have a building that is approved, has the right use permit.
Mm-hmm.
And so, you know, if you change nothing, you should be able to file for a liquor license and that shouldn't be a problem. But if, say, you wanted to say, all right, well, I want to get all this done now. I would like a wraparound patio, and that is not in the use.
Nope.
But let's work on that now, and let's get that process going, and then, because I want what I open. But if the city or municipality or whatever wants to say, well, you have to get this done before we even approve your liquor license, even knowing that, like,
even on zoning cannot be part of your recommendation for denial.
Right. So it could conceivably be where I ask for that different use permit, and we get involved and we start getting estimates and we start spending money and time, and we just decide, you know what, I think we can wait. It shouldn't be so wrapped up in the city's process that they're going to threaten to deny you a license unless you complete that. And if they've already collected CDs, you're never going to see those again.
No. And I have had clients that had to, you know, and some of these things can be about parking. It could be, you know, hey, I want a patio. So most cities will have you have a use permit for the outdoor consumption of alcohol.
Right.
Right. That's pretty common. But you have extra seating, which sort of messes up your parking ratio.
Right.
Parking is something that, you know, really stresses people out. It stresses me out. I don't do use permits or variances for, you know, parking or anything like that. And so the city's like, well, you have to withdraw your liquor license application and then reapply and pay us another, you know, $1,600, by the way. Mm-hmm. And for a small business to pay a city, you know, $3,200, $3,300 in licensing fees just for your liquor license.
Right. Sure. They're sort of asking, they're assuming that you're going to be an expert at all this. And that's, I mean, they deal with thousands of bits of requests all the time.
Oh, yeah.
So it's a little bit unfair to put you in a difficult position. And it leads to one of the objections that we have in general about cities when they approve these licenses is they will dictate the terms of all this stuff. And like in the case that we just talked about with use permits, it's statutorily not legal for them to do it. You know, and that is something we object. It's just a difference in power. So if they said, hey, I mean, I'm not going to liken it to the old days because this did. I'm like, hey, I better see a case of beer in my office before I'll approve this. I mean, but it is like, hey, well, you better do X, Y, Z, you have to agree. And if we have questions and you don't reply within a week, we're going to have to extend the timing of this. And that's all not cool.
Yeah, it really isn't.
Because you're going to say, oh, sure, whatever. I mean, because you're just hoping that they have your best interests in mind and they don't always have that. And they just, yeah.
I mean, they also charge full licensing fees for some of the cities do full licensing fees for an acquisition of control.
Yeah.
So Andrew and I own a restaurant, and we're like, hey, Rob, why don't you invest in it?
Right. It's a cool restaurant.
Yeah. And you're like, sure, let's do it.
Right.
And then it's all the licensing fees all over again. Well,
how come you're not showing up out here?
I was.
Am I? I'm not.
Oh, why?
Rob is.
No, I'm not. You're yellow.
I was.
I know, I saw it.
Ladies and gentlemen, we are experiencing technical difficulties. Please stand by.
Hello. Yeah, now I'm back.
There you go. All right.
All right, well, we'll just...
You're back.
Figure it out. It's been a lot of editing.
Rob's like, damn it. Oh, I have to figure out how to do one of these.
Yeah. At least it's in one big chunk.
I don't... If that makes you feel better.
I don't know. I don't know anything about editing. So.
Yeah, no. I don't know when it stopped recording. You said it was when I started messing with it. Not before. All right. Well, then we got a fighting chance.
Yeah. We're fine.
It's still, there's still bleed over and the cameras and.
Sure.
Yeah. It is a new skill I'm going to have to learn. No, I know how to do it. It's just. Anyway. Where were we?
Oh, boy.
Acquisitions of control.
Oh, yeah. So we have a restaurant, and all of a sudden I said, oh, technical difficulties. I'm out. No. So you added me as a owner.
Yeah. And we have to do an acquisition of control. It makes total sense.
Yeah.
You have to get fingerprinted, get on the license, everything. But we have to pay all of those fees all over again.
That's so wild.
You two have to get re-fingerprinted too? Or?
No.
Oh, okay.
No, we're fine.
But that's by the city, not the state, right?
By the city, not the state.
Yeah.
Yeah. It's interesting.
Not
every city.
The one of the things that our new breweries find out or they didn't realize is the state licensing is relatively inexpensive compared to cities.
Oh, for sure.
But it depends on the city.
And feds are free.
And feds are free.
Yeah. So, well, they get all the tax money.
Yeah, sure. But there's no application fee. There's no fee when you get approved.
No renewals.
When you apply for the state, it's not that expensive to get a license. And then you just keep renewing it every year.
Yeah.
But cities, oh, boy, do they get. I have members reach out to me that are like, we need to make it illegal for city to charge additional fees. I went. Oh.
Yeah. Yeah. Well, I mean, so.
Well, we did pass legislation maybe 10 years ago now that says that they can't raise it. Because they kept raising them.
But that wasn't just us. That was across the board.
Oh, yeah. That was in the omnibus bill. Yeah.
Restaurants, bars, everyone was not thrilled about that situation. No. Yeah.
Mm-mm. 'Cause it was like every 6 months they were increasing them. It was out of control.
It kind of is something that we talked about briefly is this struggle with the state in how much control they want to exert over cities and cities. It's generally the larger cities which end up skewing Democratic, and it's the state which skews Republican, and this is constant battle, you know, where it's like, well, we're small government, but we're going to ban a city from banning plastic bags.
Yeah.
Which is very specific, you know, like, so it's this tension between that and then where the funds come from. And one of them is the food tax issue, you know, which some cities, I mean, you know, like we all agree that the cities have to be funded in one way or other. You know, we can disagree on how much fire and police and all that other stuff. Like that's an argument that people could have, but the cities that You know, they have their own ways of getting that money, and they're not, they get some money from the state, but you know.
Less and less all the time.
Right, right. And so, in effect, when you say all the cities, you can't tax this item any longer, they got to figure out other ways to make money. And, so even if we put a moratorium on this licensing, I mean, who knows? They can come up with some other type of license that they're going to require, right?
Yeah.
Somewhere down the road, you know?
Yeah. Like,
requirements, like, because, like, we have some of the most restrictive CO2 handling ordinances in this state that cities put, the city fire departments push for. Like, most of us are used to it, but, like, I get calls every once in a while, like, hey, I heard you guys have this really harsh CO2 criteria. I'm like, everybody here is used to it.
It's not really harsh.
Well, I mean, as compared to anywhere else, which there are literally none, no requirements.
In some states and cities, there's no requirements. I mean, it's on the National Fire Code. I mean, it's in the code. If they haven't updated it, they're not enforcing it. That's one thing.
The amount of CO2 detectors.
Yeah.
The outdoor storage stuff.
Which, are you talking about my story?
No.
When Chandler Fire wanted me to put a CO2 detector outside fire bulk tank.
Uh-huh.
And I said, it's outside. And he's giving me the story. Oh, firefighters went into a basement one time at a McDonald's and they died because there was CO2 and there was not an alarm. I was like, but this is outside, bro. Like, what are you talking about? We can't get CO2 high enough outside from this tank.
Right.
I had to go through that.
Yeah.
Well, it was pretty silly.
I mean, it's easy enough to say, well, where you don't have a basement.
In a whole other side of it is that in the same municipality where I had to put in four in our 18,000 square foot warehouse, we had to have four CO2 detectors plus ones in the walk-in cooler. Same municipality, another brewery opened maybe a year after the brewery I built. No CO2s. Oh, yeah. I was like, do you hear that? Yeah. Oh, one of your couplers is not attached to the keg, right? And you're just spewing CO2 out in this room right now. Oh, yeah. Sometimes when I come in here, I get a little lightheaded. I'm like, oh, God.
So the cities will argue, mm-hmm. you know, in their defense, like you were saying that, you know, they need funds to operate and so forth, that, you know, every liquor license has to go through multiple departments, and they do a lot of work on every single application. There's no doubt about it. It goes through, you know, tax, licensing, fire, police. Mm-hmm. I mean, it touches almost every department at the city. You know, you could say, well, does it need to? Well, certainly some of them do. Maybe not all of them.
Mm-hmm.
Do you need to do that for an acquisition of control? Probably not. They just need to figure out whether or not you can pass the background, because it's already been approved for location. It's already been approved for that use.
Yeah.
We're just adding you.
Yeah. Well, me and my criminal background.
Yeah.
But that does.
Andrew, I think we need a new partner.
that does bring up a thing, because, like, I know that I have to get fingerprinted every year for the tribe, because we have an event on tribal land, Salt River Fields. And then I have to get fingerprinted by the state. And, like, I'm like, why don't they work together? Why isn't there this clearinghouse at the state level at least? You know, I don't know if this has to do with people's Second Amendment rights, or I don't have
sovereign nation.
No, I know it is. Yeah. I mean, they're a different government. That's 100%. But, like, it just seems to be the fact that I have to do it separately and different. And, you know, that I have a thing that says I can get on a plane and wear my shoes. Like, I don't know. It just seems like the inefficiencies tell me, like, oh, well, maybe some things are slipping through the cracks because there are different agencies doing the same work, probably some less diligent than others. That's all. It's just, like, I know we need to make sure the right people get liquor licenses. You know, I also know that in this state that hasn't happened even as recently as a 5 or 6 years ago, we had some, even somebody in our industry took over a business that had a background. So do you want to know who?
No. So let's talk about the extension of premise whole thing that got this started.
Yeah.
So what was the deal?
Well, I just...
So, if you're applying for an extension of premise...
If you're applying for... In certain cities...
Uh-huh.
You now need about 90 days. From submission to approval. And certain cities will toll that time if they have a question. So you get an email that says, we're reviewing your temporary extension of premises, or premise, it's licensed premises.
Yeah.
So extension of premises, right? But it's only one premise. Yeah.
Okay.
I think the statute says premises, but I think grammatically it should just be the premise.
Okay, fair.
We'll fix that next year.
Okay. Anyway, they get, so they have a question.
Right.
And they'll write you an email that says, well, we're going to stop the time.
Right.
So it actually could take longer than 90 days. Now, the good thing is.
It's like an NBA last 2 minutes could be like 30 minutes.
Yeah. So the good thing is that you could get all of your temporary extensions of premises approved at once for 6 months.
Right. So,
but it has to be the same extension. Mm-hmm. So you can't be like, oh, this is my extension to extend my patio out by 10 feet for, you know, this nice weather. But then also this is my extension to go out to the parking lot. No, that's two different. Ones. Mm-hmm. And those are two different applications, two different processes, fees, all sorts of stuff. Plan really early.
Well, this is the issue that I have is that they treat all events, whether there's a couple extra tables or 10,000 people.
They treat them all the same.
They treat them all the same. And there's no accounting for scale. No. And also there's no accounting for, this is a business that we've worked with many, many years.
This is the same thing they ask for every single year.
Right. Like,
and some cities do that.
Yeah. They'll work with you on that level, but they don't have to.
No.
So as an example, we were able to get, you know, when we were doing many, many years at with City of Phoenix with Strong Beer, we were able to get past some of that. But technically speaking, someone could say, well, no. You do have to follow all these deadlines now. Tucson, this is our eighth year. I would hope that, and really not a lot has changed with the footprint we put together and all that stuff. So to some degree, they're working with us, but they could just say, we're holding everybody to the exact same schedule. They have to go through a lot of these applications, there's no doubt about it. And somewhere down the line is somebody who's getting minimum wage that is doing a lot of work and getting a lot of hassle and harassment from a certain percentage of the people who apply. And, it's inherently frustrating for everybody. I get that, but.
In multiple departments, right? You have employees that are trying to do the best job that they can.
Right.
With all sorts of pressure.
Right.
Yeah.
But, we did years ago have this approved state contractor, but really they tell me there's deference placed towards us when we apply. To some degree there is, but there's nothing guaranteeing that they'll treat ours any differently, even though, we can point to our organization having a pretty spotless record on all that stuff. But I don't know, you would think for their own sanity,
yeah,
they would say, oh, you're doing this and you're doing this a couple times. why don't you give me the maximum area that you're ever going to use? And, you know, that way you can sort of be flexible. But I suppose they charge you based on the size of the area, or no?
Most cities don't. Yeah. Most cities treat you exactly the same, whether or not your extended space is to accommodate 50 people or 500, 2,000 people.
Right.
So, and that, you know, that's one of my main issues, is that it's really burdensome and very difficult to get an extension that, you know, extends a patio for, you know, let's say 500 square feet.
Right.
That just, you know, you just want it for a couple weekends in the spring.
Right.
So
I guess the premise that the city has is that these are scheduled and knowable events, and that's not how things work in business. Like, especially, you could say, oh, let's just pick downtown Mesa for some reason. You can say, oh, you're always going to want St. Patrick's Day and these known holidays.
Right.
And, but there's no knowing that far in advance necessarily that, oh, there is a huge convention happening at the Mesa Convention Center. And
they know. You don't know.
Right.
You have no idea.
Right. But even if you know, like, you don't know that those are necessarily your customers, and you're like, oh, they are actually, you know, alcohol adjacent industry or I heard
teachers,
alcohol adjacent industry. I said that, or you know, like, oh, I heard, you know, from people 5 years ago when they're here, this is our crowd. You don't necessarily have 90 days to pull that off.
No.
The classic thing that we talked about is winning and being in the World Series. Like, there's absolutely no way to predict that. No.
Right. Well, the other problem with putting so much burden on licensees is then they are incentivized to just ignore the rules and do it anyways. And that's what we as an organization are trying to avoid by making these things less burdensome on licensees, is we want everyone to remain compliant.
Right. And that's the message that I said, is like, if there's no accounting for scale, and if you position all this towards very large events, you're going to get people who aren't even going to bother to apply. And that's not what the department wants. I mean, they're not going to inspect every one of these things, but they probably want to know about it. And just as an economic engine driver, you want that data. Like, hey, you want to capture all that information in terms of, like, you know, and they would know what we know, is like, these spontaneous happenings are some of the most money-making things that a business can do. And, you know, especially after the pandemic, I just talked to Ron Amnias from
Main Ingredient.
And he said, yeah, we had the biggest Sunday we've ever had. And, you know, I mean, his property is limiting because it's already fenced. But, you know, like, hypothetically, if he could have extended a few more tables, like, that's enough money to carry them a few more bad weekends, right? And that's the flexibility that we're looking for. And, you know, I don't know, like, you know, when I was in France, I mean, everyone's pushing out to the sidewalk. Like, maybe they have a more archaic structure than anything else. But
people walk around the streets with booze?
Well, I was just going to bring that up. There is a bill that comes out every year in California about extending public drinking areas so that it's more open campus. And for some reason, it was written about
Dave Infante's
Fingers
newsletter.
Right. So I don't know if there's an expectation that this might actually go somewhere. I mean, it's something that I've always talked about.
It's like, his new format where he has Lobbying Tuesday, and all the rules, all the new laws get put in that week. And it's pretty cool for us. I mean,
yeah,
really cool for us, because we can say a whole other country, but they didn't have any of our stuff in there.
Yeah. No.
So there were probably 40 states that weren't represented in that newsletter, but
the big story was that. And, you know, like, speaking of World Series, I remember we won the World Series the last time, and, you know, nobody went out afterwards because there was nowhere to go, because no one knew what to expect. And before all the games, like, I don't know, like, everybody has a notional area. I'm like, just, you know, draw a circle around that map. I'm like, we should be able to go walk around with beverages and encourage people to, you know, come earlier, stay longer. I mean, you know, but if as soon as you got in your car, you were shepherded to all the way out to 16th Street before you could even turn around and come back and park. You know, it's, I don't know. I just think that would be cool. The airport thing I've always complained about, like you should be able to walk around with a beverage like all the other, by the way, all the cities that we are losing conventions to are the cities that are doing these kinds of things. You know, smaller cities, right? San Antonio, Nashville, you know, I don't know.
It's I think you have to balance, you know, the public safety aspect of it, right?
And I don't know a city that doesn't want to spend more money on police, so and overtime. So, they can throw as many cops at it as they want.
So and they do need time to process the applications. It just wasn't that long ago when you could get a temporary extension of premises in about 10 days.
Mm-hmm.
You know, the DLLC would process it in a couple of days, and the cities would, you know, look at it and say, oh, okay. You know, and most of the extensions of premises that I do aren't very big at all. You're talking about, you know, maybe seating 50 extra people. So I feel like there is a happy medium between what's going on now and still making sure everybody's safe.
Yeah. Well, we had an event that that wanted a extension of premise in a municipality.
Did not get it,
and we found
flat out denied.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. And they had at least 30 days of discussion about it.
Yeah.
And it seemed pretty basic to me, but I didn't realize this because I haven't applied for anything like that. But all of the extensions for liquor license places end up going to the Department of Parks.
In that city.
Which is, they have a staffing issue that they thought that would solve, but that seems to be completely...
Yeah.
Irrational to expect a park employee to be able to.
And this extension was not on a park.
No, not at all.
It was in a retail shopping center that already had existing licenses.
Right.
Right.
Right. So.
And it wasn't an event for 2,000 people or even 1,000 people.
Right.
No, not at all.
It was relatively small. And so, you know,
it was eventually done within the liquor license area, and there was room to spare. So it
would have been fun to have it outside.
It wasn't that they needed necessarily to be outside to have more people. It was more about the event needed a different platform or focus.
Yeah.
There just was too hard to work around the hardscape of the interior of the premise. That's all. And so you know, it was going to get that many customers. I mean, maybe they got a small bump from, they would have got a small bump from having more room, but not necessarily. I mean, everybody who was there was there.
Yeah.
So it's things like that that are super frustrating, especially when we were like, okay, we'll agree to some of this stuff, but it's really hard to agree to things statewide when you don't know who's asking for things and why. You know,
the camera's hot.
Oh my God. All right. We'll keep going. We'll finish the point anyway. Cause we have these two and I can more editing. It's just frustrating when we have the discussion and this is obviously not directly tied to, but this is exactly the kind of scenario we're talking about. Like,
and it's infuriating for business owners.
Yeah.
It feels like, you know, I should not have to worry about this on top of everything else I need to worry about.
And so I always bring...
And like, this is not something that should take up so much of my time that they have to pay for that it does.
So I just, you know, not that I'm picking on this particular segment of our industry, but like I compare that to a resort that has a liquor license permanently.
Or a golf course.
Over the entirety of their property.
Right.
And so,
and there is no control.
Not to the degree that they want everybody else to have. I mean, you know, I mean, it's a little fuzzy to me that they, you can drink, you can bring your own beverages to your room from wherever and drink, but like they do room service right to your door. So like, where does that hand off? Right.
Like, and you can leave the bar at the front desk and walk to your room or
right.
hang out in front.
Right.
Yeah. And all of that. It's fine.
Well, they have different license.
But the onus is you have to have a controlled area, right?
Yeah. But they have.
I know they have a different license, but they have different expectations, and I'm sometimes wondering why.
They're set to different standards.
Yeah, yeah. So if I have a festival and I have places for some people to sleep, then I somehow have a different. I have less responsibility over their. I have less.
There are
requirement to control their behavior.
You know, there are events that do mm-hmm. need a lot of controls.
Yeah.
No doubt.
Sure.
But again, we started with this with the mm-hmm. with your statement that they don't differentiate between the size of the event.
Right.
That I think would really solve a lot of problems.
Right.
And could get people on the same page.
I agree. Yeah. And it could be by square footage, it could be by
attendance.
Yeah. I don't know. Like, I also think somewhere down the line, you're being a license holder in pretty good standing should go somewhere too. But I mean, I guess where do you draw that line? I mean,
okay.
Yeah.
We all agree, but
all right.
We're all in agreement here.
Yeah.
The mechanism for getting that done is not happening this session, but I don't know how that changes, especially because so many of those things are just left up to the local governing body and they can pretty much manage it however they want. Yeah. Like they could say, mm-hmm. you just have to go to the city council, right. City council votes on it and you're good to go. Or they can say, we have 8 departments and you have to come in for 4 meetings in the next 2 weeks. They can do whatever they want.
So for a new liquor license, what's the statutory requirement at the state level for how long it should take?
105 days.
So you're suggesting that some of the cities are taking all full 90 days?
And then the DLLC gets an extra 30.
Okay, well, that's 120 days.
Right.
That's where we're at. So
that's
by de facto.
Somehow we've gotten to a place that's where we're at.
So the does that apply to, does the same time constraint apply to these extensions of premise, or there is no... Is there any state structure that says how long that should take or no?
Yes.
Okay.
Yes. The statute says 60 days.
60 days.
Right.
But my understanding is that the cities want 90 of the 60 days.
They want 90 of the 60 days.
So the state really.
So they might not explicitly say. No, I'm pretty sure on at least one website it says we highly recommend 90 days.
Yeah, mm-hmm. Yeah, they do.
Okay.
Uh-huh. That's where I got that from. I mean, that's...
Yeah, so, but the statute says 60.
Yeah.
The statute doesn't say anything regarding the DLLC, but the form says 30.
Mm-hmm. And at least for series... 15 licenses, the state will do one in 10 days, but I've gotten it in a day.
Yeah.
We have a meeting on Tuesday.
We do. With?
In Tucson.
Oh, we do.
Yeah.
Oh, so I sort of feel like that would be very beneficial. It's just a quick 10-minute phone call of what do you guys want to do and why? And how many people do you expect there? I mean, they ask all those questions.
Yeah.
But it's better to sometimes have that.
Yeah, you know,
conversation.
We have whatever their recommended days. We've We've sometimes been, they've given us a break on it. But again, we've done this for, what are you doing?
I have emailed Danny to make sure.
Oh.
And I know they don't work on Fridays.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
Oh, yeah. Ooh. Oh, it's Thursday, yes.
So, they've, Tucson has changed their process and they have more of a customer service agent.
Yeah.
That works with us. But again, like, you know, we haven't changed the structure of that event largely over the course of 8 years. So it's pretty much the same except the dates.
Yeah.
You know, so I'm that's fine. But like, you know, honestly though, they could say, oh yeah, well, you know, you've done this in the past and this amount of time and, you know, this is the process, but yeah, we're going to hold you to the policy or the law or whatever the municipal scenario that they have drawn out. Like, all right, well, then we're kind of screwed. But so the state has like this way of saying, you know, here's how much time it should take. But all these cities have their own solution to that, and that's the problem. So it's really hard to say, hey, we'll work with you on this. But like, I don't know who I'm working with. Am I working with the city of Phoenix? Am I working with, you know, Marana? Am I working with,
yeah,
like, what am I working with here? And the specific ask, does it have a use case that is very particular to them? And like, you know, I mean, we don't want to go say, hey, okay, and then we find out that they have a beef with a particular business and the way they do things. And like, so the Brewers Guild wants to screw with our way of doing it. I don't know. Like, it's just very, they won't tell us, right? I mean, so I don't know. It's pretty nebulous, but that seems to be something that we need to work on somewhere, yeah. At least have discussions, because it's just been run through their lobbyist. And like, I don't know, like, I don't mind talking to those folks. Like, I super do have extreme sympathy for the people who have to contend with all the laws and all the directors from the cities. I'm like, you know, they have to deal with our nonsense and they don't get paid a lot. So I don't want to sound like I don't know, screw you. This is how many days it's supposed to take. But I don't know.
We have to get the businesses aren't just hanging out to have fun.
No.
They're trying to get some business done to make money, take care of their customers. They have employees to worry about too. The city should want those tax dollars.
Yeah. Yeah, I don't know. If there was a way to understand what that unmet potential for to be flexible on some of these things would be.
Let's talk about the feds.
We're going to talk about the feds.
I mean, we really went through that very extensively.
Oh, the labeling?
Andrew's board.
No, our extension of premise.
Oh. Yeah.
Well, it's a big deal.
Yeah, it is a big deal. And plus, 10 minutes of this discussion may be gone and I will never find it again. We'll see.
Could be.
Just splice it in and like, what? I missed the whole thing. I don't even get what we're talking about. Yeah. All right. So go ahead.
Labels. Kick it off,
man. Yeah. So we had the TTB had a public listening session.
Right.
Yes. I mean, we could have called in too.
Yeah. I mean,
I'm so glad we did it.
That would have been amazing. We might be on deck next.
Yeah. They scheduled 4 hours.
Yeah.
And we didn't hang for 4 hours.
No.
We hung for 2.5 and.
Yeah. But 30 minutes of it was laying out the ground rules and how they work. The channeling works, for technical issues. You can't put things in the chat. You have to sign up to be a speaker and.
Yep.
And they give you 5 minutes, which is why it's 4 hours.
And then you have to add 5 minutes for turn on your mic.
Unmute yourself.
If you'd like to turn your camera on.
Yeah. Yeah.
So the changes are regarding allergy labeling,
mm-hmm.
nutritional
ingredient, and potentially ABV, because that's not required right now.
Well, it's not standardized
either, right?
Because some states
prohibit it.
Prohibited it, yeah.
Some states require it and some states allow it.
Right. They didn't want...
What?
They seem to feel like high-strength labeling, ABV labels, would encourage more drinking when clearly that's not the trend these days.
Right, right.
Although I will say at Spin the Bottle, we do get asked,
mm-hmm.
what's your strongest beer?
Oh, wow.
I'm like, I think you're in the wrong shop, but.
Have this one and power this bottle of wine down at the same time. That's how you get there.
What's your strongest beer? It's this one if you have two.
Yeah. Yeah. No, but also, is it still the case that some states do ABW?
I know that.
It was a southern states thing.
I know that Oklahoma used to have the, you had to have 4.2 ABW or less, or 3.2 or whatever.
They did it by weight, not by volume.
Yeah, so anyways, just another example of inconsistencies between the states that causes consumer confusion, especially because we have such a transient society. People move a lot.
Travel.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, so they're trying to get that. Maybe they'll get that nailed down.
So this has historically been resisted by us and the Brewers Association.
Requiring ABV?
No, generally more labeling requirements, but specifically the nutritional information, because I don't know, a figure was thrown out there. I don't know if it's completely accurate, but it sounds reasonable. $400 to $500 to get your those panels for nutrition.
Yeah, if you take your finished beer and send it to a lab, they will send you back the nutritional information. And if you can even imagine, you're in a brewery and your beer's finished, and now you have to wait for the nutritional, send it to a lab,
right?
Wait for it to come back. Who knows how long that's going to take? And then make the label for it,
right? And who has no problem with that?
Spirits.
And larger breweries that have a very consistent product, and their product never varies.
And they, probably an in-house lab.
And they can blend it and all that stuff. It really kills innovation, which is what we're supposed to be about. You know, it's not just, oh, it's difficult and it costs money.
I mean, you would have beer done for a month sitting in a tank.
Yeah.
Holding up that tank from being able to be turned, potentially. I mean, you could package it without a label.
Then put a sticker on
and then something else.
That doesn't seem right.
So you would really kill productivity opportunities.
So I know that the Brewers Association has sort of now agreed to have theoretical values based on recipe formulation. But I mean, that doesn't solve everything. I mean, you throw some peanut butter in there, you throw in fruit or whatever, like, I don't know how they account for all those levels, but we'll see.
Well, so, the other alternative is a QR code.
Well, I mean, but I'm just like saying in terms of having those values kind of spit out based on some sort of spreadsheet, you know, or database that presumably the Brewers Association would manage to some degree or something like that.
Oh, you mean like, oh, what if I put in some, like, four little things of lychee? How does that affect our...
Well, that's just what I don't know. Yeah, well, I mean, that's where the allergens come in, too. And the Brewers Association identified 7 or 9 known allergens. I think those are basically the same ones that our restaurants have to contend with, although I think it's only 5 restaurants. I'm not sure.
Someone said 9 allergens contributed to 90% of total food allergies.
Right. Right.
I don't know.
Anyway, like, so there's the mechanics of that, the cost of that. The Brewers Association is like, well, here's a middle ground. They didn't offer that as a they told us that might be on the table. We've been talking about this for 5 years.
Yeah,
that might be on the table. But it sounds like officially they're saying that. I know a couple states within the Brewers Association have reached out to everybody else. It's like, are you down with this? I'm like, because a lot of those breweries aren't. I don't know. I don't presume to know how our brewery's going to feel about it. I just don't think we have the power to stop that. If the Brewers Association is going to go one direction on it, I don't really think we have a lot of weight to it. And I don't know. I said, well, if they treat it as seriously as some of the
current labeling,
current labeling requirements in terms of bold type of a certain size, contrast levels, then if they treat it like that, then we don't have a lot to worry about. But You know, the mandatory requirements on labels take up a lot of real estate already. So QR code was suggested. You know, there's problems inherently with that. Who hosts it? What happens if your web server goes down or things like that?
Well, you'd clearly be non-compliant.
Well, I know that, but where's the? I mean, you're ultimately on the hook, but you know, AT&T went down for. So does if your entire internet service has come out, is your CAN now non-compliant for an entire swath of the country?
Wild.
I don't know. Like, it's just questions I have. But it sounds like something is going to happen fairly soon.
There's going to be allergen warnings. There's going to be
some nutritional data.
And some nutritional data. And
ingredients. I think people were
pretty
consistent on that.
Listed ingredients.
Yeah.
Wow. I hope that can all be handled through a QR code because
that's
a lot of space on a label.
Yeah, that is.
Right. I mean, and you know, we're looking at 12-ounce cans, but that's not necessarily the smallest package size I've seen.
Right. Yeah, and
what is going on? Oh, my lovely wife is calling me. I should probably.
Oh, I thought that was mine buzzing.
No, it's me.
Well, US-12-FLOZ, is that correct?
12 fluid ounces?
Yeah.
I don't know.
I know you can't put a pint. You can't. It's very complicated. I've gone through some of those labeling classes, but yeah.
Well, this is 1 pint, but this is an NA.
Yeah, that doesn't. Well, there's.
Oh, now my phone's ringing.
There's other issues with that.
Yeah. Well, anyway, that's the outline of the problem that we'll probably be talking about more in the future.
I mean, these, and we are asking for a 3-year grace period to implement everything, to go through labels and go through cans and all that. And so I don't think they're going to push back against that.
No, I don't think so either. And I think, you know, people, you know, it wasn't the topic to discuss, but it was relevant that people brought up, hey, you know, already the TTB objects to style considerations and other things that aren't necessarily have not a lot to do with public safety. And it's just, they're holding us to a standard of, this goes back to when there was one guy working the whole thing, his opinion mattered.
And someone actually suggested we should go back to that.
No,
not someone who's very smart. Clearly the point was we need to go back to having one person in charge of it. Because then we'll get consistent answers. And I think that's just a silly way of trying to get a consistent answer.
Right. You should have a consistent process. And that's all we care about.
Right.
But you can talk to a lot of brewers that go through this. By the way, you know.
And they could exempt breweries that if you produce less than X amount of barrels, you don't have to comply with this. Maybe you have to comply with the allergens, but you don't have to comply with the... I mean, they did it for restaurants, right? Like, not every restaurant has
to. Chains,
Yeah, but if you own more than X amount of locations, I think it was 20, 6 or 20, something like that. But it was a while ago, and there was a grace period and so forth, but they should do the same thing for alcohol manufacturers.
I should go to some chains and ask for the menu with all the nutritional data. I bet they scramble and I bet they don't have that on hand a lot of times.
There's one giant book sitting at the host stand. They're like, here you go, sir.
Conk. Right. It doesn't have your new potato salad on here. I could die.
You're fired.
Anyway, that's the issue. We actually have more than 43 minutes on here. So if you don't mind, we should probably leave something on the table here for another time.
Yeah.
I'll be back soon.
Yeah.
It's been like 6 months.
And then we can just have like adventures in retail.
Yes.
And you can tell us all your stories.
Oh, I already have lots of spin the bottle stories. Uh-huh. It's good. It's fun.
Ever have to throw anyone out? Kinda. I know you told me kinda.
I have refused to sell to people. Yeah. Absolutely.
And they've left on their own accord. You didn't have to collar them by the ear.
Luckily, no. Yeah, but there have been times.
Yeah.
I mean, not once I had to do that.
Did they say what's your strongest beer?
I don't think they said much of anything. They it was just words.
Yeah.
I don't think it was enough to have a sentence. And I'm like, I can't sell to you. I'm sorry, I can't.
Yeah, I mean, it would be bad enough for me to be the guy at Arizona Strong who didn't give the drink ticket when I had a sample.
Yeah.
And get busted for that. It would be so much worse for you to get busted for selling someone.
All right, we got to go. Thank you so much for being here. And, you know, I don't want everyone to think like, oh, we haven't talked to Camila. We talk.
Oh, yeah, we talk all the time.
just remember, this is not a beer podcast. It's a podcast about beer.
Yes.